This is the second lecture on permutations, and which are very important. So let's just recall. A permutation on a set X is a function sigma from X to itself that is 1 to 1 and onto. So the simplest example is the identity function. ID sub x, and it's defined by the identity applied to x is equal to x for all x in the set capital X. And composition of functions is associative always. ID of X is an identity, is the identity. And every 1 to 1 and onto function has an inverse function. So if we have sigma going from X to X, there's another function sigma inverse from X to X that has the property that sigma composed with sigma inverse and sigma inverse composed with sigma is the identity. So for any set X, the permutations form a group. And the binary operation, the multiplication, is composition of functions. So we study a lot permutations of finite sets. And if you have a finite set of n elements, it doesn't matter what they're called. So we can just as well take X to be the set of the first n positive integers. And the permutation group we denote by S sub n, which is called the symmetric group. So, and the standard way to write a permutation, the standard form of a permutation is sigma equals, so for sigma in Sn, it's a function. So it maps the integers 1 to n to themselves. And I can write this as like a little matrix with 2 rows, each with n elements. And I write 1 to n in the top. And in the second row, sigma of 1, sigma of 2, sigma of 3, up to sigma of n. So for example, if n is equal to 8, and I take the permutation 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 3, 7, 2, 6, 1, 4, 5, 4, 8, 5, this is a permutation in S8. And it's a function. And sigma of 1 is equal to 3. Sigma of 7 is equal to 8, and so on. So that's the standard form of a permutation. Now, there are some very simple permutations. The simplest permutation is something called a transposition. A transposition is a permutation that interchanges two numbers and leaves every other number fixed. Just to be very precise about what it means to say something is fixed, a fixed point of a permutation on a set X is an element, permutation sigma is an element X in the set such that sigma of X equals X. So if you think of the permutation as moving elements around, an element that doesn't move is fixed under the permutation. So in a transposition, two numbers are not fixed, they're switched. Every other number is a fixed point. So for example, the permutation 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 2, 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. This is a transposition. Because 1 goes to 2 and 2 goes to 1, so they're switched. But 3 goes to 3, 4 goes to 4, every other number goes to itself. And the notation for a transposition is A comma B. So A comma B is the permutation that transposes or switches A and B and leaves every other number fixed. These are really the very simplest permutations. We can think of a transposition as A goes to B and B goes back to A. The next slightly more complicated, but still pretty simple permutation is called a cycle. A cycle is a permutation of the form. So let's say you have a number A1, it goes to A2. A2 goes to A3. A3 goes to A4. A4 goes to A5. A5 goes to A6, and A6 goes back to 1. So a permutation like this is called a cycle because you can sort of draw it as a circle. This goes to this, goes to this, goes to this, and sigma of X equals X for all X not equal to any of the elements in the permutation. So this would be a cycle of length 6. So there's 6 numbers as you go around the circle. And the notation for a cycle, it really just extends the notation for a transposition. A transposition is a cycle of length 2. So a cycle of length L, you just write L numbers like this, A1 up to A sub L. So for example, here's a cycle. Let's just do it in S6. 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, 3 goes to 1, 4 goes to 4, 5 goes to 5, and 6 goes to 6. This is the cycle 1, 2, 3. 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, 3 goes to 1. Everything else is fixed. Now, with a cycle, you can notice the cycle 1, 2, 3 is also the same as the cycle 2, 3, 1. Because 2 goes to 3, 3 goes to 1, 1 goes to 2. It's also the same as the cycle 3, 1, 2. 3 goes to 1, 1 goes to 2. So there's not a unique way to write a cycle just because it's kind of a circle. You can take any point on the circle as the starting point when you write the note, write down the cycle. So this notation isn't unique. Just the way for a transposition, the transposition AB is the same as the transposition BA. They're the same thing. And what's very nice about cycles is they give a way to factor an arbitrary permutation. So just the way in elementary number theory, you can factor a positive integer into a product of prime numbers. In group theory, you can factor a permutation into a product of cycles. Let me make one or two comments first. Suppose we have two cycles. Suppose we have a cycle A1, A2, up to A sub K, and B1, B2, up to B sub L, in some permutation group Sn. So these cycles are said to be disjoint if the numbers in here and the numbers in here are all different. So AI is different from BJ for all I going from 1 to K and J going from 1 to L. So for example, 1, 7, 8 and 2, 3, 6, 11 are disjoint cycles. Plus 1, 7, 8, those numbers are different from 2, 3, 6, 11. These are disjoint cycles. And a very important simple lemma says that disjoint cycles commute. So suppose we have sigma A1 up to AK and tau V1 up to BL, disjoint cycles. So we have A1 up to AK and B1 up to BL. These are integers, disjoint cycles in Sn. So these are integers in the set 1, 2, 3, 4, up to n. So if C is a number in this set, 1 up to n, and C is not equal to any AI or any BJ, then what is sigma tau applied to C? Well, sigma tau applied to C, this is sigma of tau of C. C is not one of the B's, so C is fixed under tau. So tau of C is sigma of C. C is fixed under tau. But C is also not one of these numbers, A1 up to AK. So sigma of C is equal to C. So sigma is fixed under tau and C. So and sigma. And what about tau sigma? So tau sigma of C is tau of sigma of C. That's tau of C is equal to C. So therefore, the permutation sigma tau is the same as the permutation tau sigma for all C not equal to AI or BJ. Well, what about if C is equal to one of them? What's sigma tau of AI? Sigma tau of AI is sigma of tau of AI. AI is not one of the B's. So tau of AI is AI. And sigma of AI is AI plus one, it moves it around. Or sigma of, unless I is equal to K, in which case sigma of AK is equal to A1. What about tau sigma of AI? So that's tau of sigma of AI. That's tau of AI plus one, if I is not equal to N. And AI plus one is not one of the B's, so this is AI plus one. And if I is equal to K, tau of sigma of AI is tau of A1, which is equal to A1. But in both cases, sigma tau equals tau C for all AI. And similarly, sigma tau equals tau sigma for all VJ. So sigma tau equals tau sigma. So when you have disjoint cycles, they commute with each other in the multiplication in the group. If you take any permutation sigma, so maybe I'll state this also as a, well, maybe a theorem. I need to write the word theorem. Every permutation is a product of pairwise disjoint cycles. So before I prove it, let me just give an example. Suppose I take a permutation in S11. And let's say this is the permutation. Let's see if I have every number. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So that's a permutation. So let's try to look at what happens in this permutation. If you take the number 1, 1 gets sent to 7. 7 gets sent to 11. 11 gets mapped by sigma to 9. 9 goes to 10. 10 goes back to 1. So this is like a little cycle that's built into sigma. See, what's the number I haven't used yet? 2. Well, 2 goes to 8. 8 goes to 9. 9 goes to 10. 10 goes to, oops, let's see, something has to be wrong here. 1 goes to 7. 7 goes to 11. 11 goes to 9. 9 goes to 10, and 10 goes to 1. 2 goes to 8. 8 is mapped to 6. 6 goes to 5. 5 goes back to 2. So that's another cycle. What haven't I used? 3 goes to 4, goes back to 3. So sigma is the product of these three cycles. This is a 5 cycle. This is a 4 cycle. This is a 2 cycle, or a transposition. And this algorithm, if you like, always works. Given any permutation, you can always decompose it into a product of disjoint cycles. These disjoint cycles commute, but this representation is unique up to, just as with primes and numbers, like 6 is 2 times 3 or 3 times 2. This permutation is this times this times this, or any way you want to rearrange it. And maybe I'll just stop here in lieu of a proof. You can always go through this process. So every permutation is a product of disjoint cycles. But then we can say something even more and even more interesting. Every cycle is a product of transpositions. Not necessarily disjoint. Let's just do an example. Suppose I have a three cycle, one, two, three. I think I can write this as a product of two transpositions. Let's see. What does this do? These are functions acting on the right. So this function sends 1 to 2 and 2 to 2, so 1 goes to 2. This sends 2 to the 1 and then 1 to 3, so 2 goes to 3. This sends 3 to 3 and then 3. Ah, so we did it. This three cycle is a product of two transpositions. And there's nothing special about 1, 2, and 3. For any numbers, A1, A2, A3, this would be A1, A3, A1, A2. So every three cycle is a product of transpositions. What about a four cycle? I bet this works. Let's look at this. So this says 1 to 2 to 2 to 2, 2 to 1 to 3, 3 to 3 to 1 to 4, 4 to 4. Ah, that works. And probably if you take any K cycle, you can write that as a product of K minus 1 transpositions. 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3. This always works. Now that is remarkable. So the very simplest cycles are transpositions, two cycles. And we have now two ways to write permutations or to factor permutations. One is to factor a permutation into a product of disjoint cycles. The other, and that's unique, up to order, the order in which you write the cycles, there's only one way to do that. The other is to write a permutation as a product of transpositions. In that case, the transpositions are not disjoint. They involve same number occurs in multiple transpositions. And I should also point out that the number of transpositions you use is not uniquely determined. So let me make a remark about that. Recall that the order of an element in a finite group, an element X in a finite group G, is the smallest integer K such that X to the K is the identity. So in Sn, a transposition has order 2. If sigma interchanges A and B, then, so this is not the identity, but what is sigma squared? That means sigma composed with sigma. So A goes to B goes back to A, B goes to A goes back to B, and for any C different from A or B, C goes to C goes to C. So sigma has order 2, a transposition. in general, a K cycle A1, A2, up to A sub K has order K minus one. For example, if sigma is the three cycle, 1, 2, 3, then if you take the number one, it gets sent to 2 gets sent to, so this is under sigma, 2 gets sent to 3 under sigma, so this is sigma squared, and 3 gets sent back to 1, so this is sigma cubed, and that's true for 2 and 3 as well. So it takes, 1 goes to 2, a cycle of length k has order k. So this is a cycle of length 3, and sigma cubed is the identity. Just write it as E, the identity. So for example, if I take the permutation sigma equal 1, 2, 3, I can write that as a product of two transpositions. I can also write that as a product of four transpositions, because this is just the identity. Or I can write that as 1, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 4, 5. Because these commute and these are the identity. So, and maybe even, 6, 7, 6, 7. So this is an important observation. The number of transpositions in the factoring of a permutation as a product of transpositions is not unique. So it's not the case that when you factor a permutation into a product of transpositions, it involves maybe 7 transpositions and no other number. No, the number is not unique. Here we have this permutation as a product of 2 transpositions, 4, 6. So there are many, many, many different ways to factor a permutation as a product of transpositions. And the number is not determined. But we have the following amazing fact. Let sigma be a permutation in Sn. If sigma is factored into a product of R transpositions one way, and it also factors into a product tau 1 prime, tau 2 prime, up to tau sub s prime. It's a product of s transpositions. Then R and s are either both even or both odd. That is, you can't write a permutation in one way as a product of an even number of transpositions and in a different way as a product of an odd number of transpositions. So if sigma has a decomposition into R transpositions and a second decomposition into a product of S transpositions, then R must be congruent to S. Not congruent. R is congruent to S mod 2. And I will prove that in a minute, but as a corollary of that, suppose we let An be the set of all permutations in the symmetric group Sn, such that sigma is a product of an even number of transpositions. So An is closed under multiplication. If sigma 1 is a product of 2k transpositions, and sigma 2 is a product of another even number, 2l transpositions, then I can always write sigma 1, sigma 2 is tau 1 up to tau 2k, tau 1 prime up to tau 2l prime. Here I have 2k plus 2l, which is 2 times k plus l. This is also an even number of transpositions. So the product of two permutations in the set Sn is also in Sn. So this set Sn is closed under multiplication. The identity permutation, I can write that as, let's say, 1, 2 times 1, 2, because they cancel. 2 is an even number. So this is also in An. And if sigma is a product of k transpositions, then sigma inverse can be written as a product of the same k transpositions in the reverse order. Because if I take tau 1 up to tau k times tau k inverse down to tau 1 inverse, well, of course, for transpositions, tau inverse equals tau. So this is tau 1 up to tau k down to tau 1. And if k is even, k is even. So if sigma is in An, then sigma inverse is in An. Right, so An is a subgroup of Sn. So the set An of permutations that can be written as the product of an even number of transpositions is a subgroup. It's closed under multiplication, contains the identity, contains the inverse of each of its elements. Notice that no transposition A1, A2 is in An, or I should say maybe in a slightly positive way. So if you have a transposition An, it's not contained in this set. Because this is one, this transposition is a product of one transposition. One is an odd number. So An is a proper subgroup of Sn. It's not equal to the whole thing. In fact, An is half of Sn. The cardinality of Sn is exactly half the cardinality of Sn. Why is that? Because if sigma is in An and tau is a transposition, then sigma tau is not in An, because sigma has an even number of permutations. Sigma tau has an even number plus one, sorry, an even number of transpositions. Sigma tau is an even number plus one. So if you think of here's the group SN, and here's SN, and here's everything else, SN with AN taken away. There's a function from AN to SN minus AN, which sends every permutation to that permutation times tau. And this function is one-to-one. On a one-to-one function on a finite set. Yeah. So this function is one-to-one from here into here. But there's an inverse function. So I can go from here to here by multiplying by tau. I can go back also by multiplying by tau. And those two functions are inverses of each other. So that means that this set has the same number of elements as this set. So half, each of them is half of Sn. Let's just look at an example. So let's take the group S3. So this is the symmetric group on 1, 2, and 3. So the cardinality of S3 is 6. So the cardinality of the alternating group, oh, I should have said, this subgroup AN is called the alternating group. So if we let N equal 3, we're looking at the symmetric group S3, which has 6 elements, right? Symmetric group SN always has N factorial elements, 3 factorial is 6. So A3 will have 6 over 2 or 3 elements. What are the 3 elements? Well, the identity is in A3, because it's a product of an even number of transpositions. The cycle 1, 2, 3, which is 1, 3, 1, 2. That's two numbers, is in A3. The cycle 1, 3, 2, which is 1, 2, 1, 3, is in A3. And the transpositions, tau 1 equal 2, 3, tau 2 equal 1, 3, tau 3 equal 1, 2, these are not in A3. So those are in SN, but not A3. S3, not A3. So the group S3 is divided into two halves. The half consisting of the even permutations, permutations that use an even number of transpositions. They're the identity in the 2-3 cycles. And the 3 transpositions are odd permutations, and they're not in A3. So that's a nice. The alternating groups, they tend to have they're important. They're very nice. Let's see. So there are two things left that I want to do. One is to prove this fact that the parity of a permutation is well defined. And second, maybe I'll prove the second thing first, which is the following. I want to say something about the importance of permutation groups. And that I will put in the following theorem. So every finite group is isomorphic to a subgroup of a permutation group. In fact, every finite group is permutation to a subgroup of permutation group every finite group of order n. So if the group has n elements, it's always isomorphic to a subgroup of the permutation group Sn. So in a certain sense, if you know everything about permutation groups, you know everything about all groups. So let G be a group of order n, and let's say its elements are G1, G2, G3, up to G sub n. So I want to define a function I'll call it sigma sub x from G to itself. So for every x in G, I'm going to define a function sigma x from G to G as follows. Sigma sub x of G sub I is x times GI, just multiplication on the left. Now, what can I say about this function? So first of all, sigma x is 1 to 1. So if sigma x of GI equals sigma x of GJ, then that means that XGI equals XGJ. So if I multiply on the left by X inverse XGI, equals X inverse XGJ. This is GI and this is GJ. So therefore, sigma is 1 to 1, sigma X is 1 to 1. Sigma X is on 2. Why is that? So if GI is in G, then X inverse GI is also an element of G, because G is a group, it's closed under multiplication. And sigma X of X inverse GI is X, X inverse GI is G sub I. So that proves that sigma X is onto. So therefore, sigma X is a permutation of G. Mm-hmm. So for every element of the group, we have a permutation. So consider, so the set of all these sigma sub X's for X and G, this is some subset of the permutation, the set of all permutations of G. And I claim this is a group. So how do we prove that? Well, sigma X, sigma Y apply to any element G. The sigma X of YG, which is X times YG, which is XY times G, which is sigma XY times G. So therefore, sigma of X, sigma of Y is sigma of XY. So this permutation, this set of permutations, I'll call it Q. So Q is closed under multiplication or composition permutations. Sigma sub E of G is EG or G. So this is the identity function on G. So Q contains the identity. And sigma X inverse is sigma x x inverse, which is sigma e, which is the identity. And sigma x inverse sigma x is sigma x inverse x is sigma e, is also the identity. So Q contains inverses. So therefore Q is a group. And I claim Q is a group isomorphic to G. So suppose I define a function f from G to Q by f of x is this permutation sigma x. So this is certainly one to one. Well, f of x equals f of y, if and only if sigma x equals sigma y, if and only if x equals y. So this map is one to one. And it's onto every x goes to sigma x. And it's a homomorphism. F of x y is sigma x y, which is sigma x sigma y, which is f of x, f of y. So F is an isomorphism. So what do we have? We have G is isomorphic to this set Q, which is contained in the permutations of G. And I want to establish a one-to-one correspondence between the permutations of Q and Sn. Well, but that's pretty straightforward, I think. Suppose we have sigma be a permutation permutation of G. So sigma of GI, let me call this phi, just to suppose phi is a permutation of the group. So phi is this function from G to G that's one to one and onto, and every phi of GI is some GJ, which I can write as sigma of I. So let sigma of I be equal to this J. So if I want to write down the permutation phi, I can write it like this. I can imagine I have this 2 by n matrix. I write G1 up G2 up to Gn, and here I put where phi of, since each of these elements, phi of G1, phi of G2, up to phi of Gn, which is G1, G2, up to G sub n. And this is some G of sigma of 1, G of sigma of 2, G of sigma of n. So I can associate this permutation of the group to a certain sigma in Sn, where 1 goes to the sigma of 1, 2 goes to sigma of 2, and so forth, n goes to sigma of n. So to every permutation of G, I construct a permutation in Sn. And I guess what I want to know is that this function from the permutations of G to Sn is an isomorphism. And then a subgroup of the permutation group will be isomorphic to a subgroup of Sn. And so every group will be isomorphic to a subgroup of Sn. So let's see if it's possible to do this. Define the function I'll write it as capital phi from the permutations of G to Sn by phi of a permutation little phi is equal to this permutation sigma I just constructed. So suppose I let psi be another permutation in the permutation group of G, and phi of psi, capital phi of psi, is equal to something I call tau. So psi sends G1, G2 up to Gn to G tau of 1, G tau of 2 up to G tau of n. So if I take psi composed with phi, what does that look like? G1, G2 up to Gn. So phi sends G1 to G of sigma of 1, and tau sends G of sigma of 1 to G of tau sigma of 1, and so forth. G of n gets sent to G of tau sigma of n. So phi, capital phi of psi little phi, is tau sigma, which is phi of psi phi of little phi. So this function phi is a homomorphism. And one can check, it is certainly one to one and onto. So phi is in fact an isomorphism. And Q is sent to some subgroup of Sn. Wow. That's what I wanted to prove. So the takeaway from this is the following fact, that every group is isomorphic to a subgroup of a permutation group. That is the remarkable fact. So you can say on the one hand, it makes it possible to study all groups. Or alternatively, you can say that the study of permutation groups is extremely difficult because it contains the study of all groups. That's it.